interesting reading. It grips you. It also will help you, because I think it helped him. Nick says that at the height of his problems, he was using the drugs ecstasy and cocaine, drinking a bottle of vodka every night. He's written a memoir called Facing the Music and Living to Talk About It. Nick, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having
me,
guys.
It's so good to have you here. It's a page turner, but like you were saying, you even leave space in here to write notes, because it's one of those books where there are moments where you want to stop and reflect and make little notes for yourself.
Absolutely. You know, that's really the book itself. I mean, I wanted to give something back. You know, I wanted some people to have a resource that they could actually reach for, that mm-hmm. they can actually, you know, something that was new, because one of the things that inspired me to get better and to continue to, you know, try to evolve and become a better man was self-help books.
Yeah.
You know, and
one
one in particular.
The one that was written in the 1940s or 30s.
Well, funny. I think it was like 70s. Or the man,
Norman Vincent Peale.
I'm sure you know about him. And, sure. You know, and it was given to me actually from Kevin, and I talk about it in the book. And, you know, I didn't, he gave it to me on my birthday, and I didn't read it till
Another
years later.
Yeah.
I remember he actually dedicated it to me. And, it was given to him, passed down to him from a friend to actually help him get through the death of his father.
Let me jump into this. When you read your book, you realize, first of all, you came from a wildly loud, dysfunctional family. Mm-hmm. And on one level, you can say it's kind of like a sitcom because everybody was yelling at her, but it was really kind of tragic in a way, in terms of, for you as a little kid, not having role models around you, how to live your life. There was drinking, there was fighting, there were parents threatening.
And that was normal.
Yeah, threatening divorce all the time, going to your room and saying, who are you going to be with if we get divorced?
Totally.
All right. Yeah. And a predisposition to alcoholism. Your parents were in the booze business for a while. Mm-hmm. Everybody drank, and a lot of people were alcoholics. So here you are coming out of that. You're 12 years old, and suddenly you become a star.
Yeah.
Are you ready in any way?
I mean, well, you know, it's a double-edged sword, you know, for me, because, you know, I actually, in a lot of ways, was sort of saved by music. You know,
yeah.
It sounds cliche, but, you know, I met the guys when I was 12 years old, and I was able to sort of be plucked out of my family and,
right.
you know, dynamic and environment, put into a new one with, you know, being the youngest member of a five
Backstreet Boys.
And far younger than some of them.
Oh, totally. Yeah. You know, and that really gave me a chance to reflect, you know, this is actually how a family should treat each other. This is how you should love each other.
Your story is very different in that way, because a lot of child stars, quote unquote, the catalyst of their demise is their stardom, where mm-hmm. for you, it took you out of this bizarre family life and put you into something a little more normal.
Yeah, I mean, when you think about it, what happens is, like, you know, you're exposed to all these things, you know, and when you have, you know, that family dynamic, you know, and you're just bringing it into your later life, you know, you really don't know anything else other than what you have been taught as a, you know, a child in your family.
You go into this new world, you have sex, success and sex.
Probably a little of that,
too. A lot of that. Beyond any dreams you might have nurtured in your soul, but everything happened. Self-sabotage was around the corner for you. You did everything classically wrong to do. We talk about the booze and the drugs and pretty much throwing your life away with all this success. There was a turning point for you, and it was a health moment, was it not?
Absolutely.
All right, tell us about that.
You know, I was, I'd just gotten off tour. I was starting to have, like, sort of chest pains, and so I went to the doctor. He hooked me up to all these EKGs and stuff, and then came back and told me that I had the beginning signs of a cardiomyopathy. So I was like, you know, well, what is that? You know, after doing research, found out that it was called the sudden death syndrome due to the weakening of a heart. But mine was drug and alcohol induced from all the toxins that I was putting in my body. And, you know, that sort of, that scared me. And it really, there's many times that actually I had reality checks. But that one was one of the most important.
Right, now on to one of the most painful things in the book. Your siblings, many of them, also had the drug problems, et cetera. Your sister died. Drug-related, we assume, pills. For some reason, you got the blame from your family. That's a tough thing to take and to talk about, but I wish you would.
Yeah, no, I mean, that's, I think, the burden that I sort of carried, in a lot of ways it was sort of self-induced. I mean, I actually became the father and figure in my family, you know, became the provider with all the money that the Backstreet Boys were making, we were making, and I would start to buy houses, take care of them. And that responsibility, I think, in a lot of ways sort of, you know, it later on down the road hurt my family because they looked at me as if I was like this.
And you were in charge.
Like this, yeah. This.
Well, and what I found interesting in the book is that happened even before Backstreet Boys, when the twins were born, Aaron and your sister, right?
Yeah.
You had to take care of them.
Exactly.
And you panicked when your mom was pregnant with them, thinking, I'm going to have to take care of these kids.
Exactly. I mean,
that
there was a lot
job.
Of times. There was a lot of times, you know, and that's, you know, it's what you're in your household. You love your family. You love who everyone is. You stick together. But the dysfunction was
just. But how old were you when they were born?
Well, I was 8 years old, 9 years old.
You're changing diapers.
Exactly.
And taking care of these
kids. I was actually taking care of them.
And you had a therapist tell you later on, but not only was that wrong, it was illegal.
Yeah.
It was illegal.
Exactly.
And you say in the book, well, so what? What it would mean to me that it was illegal, I still had to do it. I want to get back to the thing about your sister as we go through this timeline. Your sister became a singer. Mm-hmm. Your sister had a little bit of success, and then she didn't. She looked to you in many ways. Mm-hmm. She needed you in many ways. Mm-hmm. She pushed you away in many ways.
Yeah.
She took things from you and then said you never gave her anything.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
She went very public with all of that. And then she was dead. Did you see that coming?
No, I did not, actually. I think you when you're living it, you feel like you can get away with anything and do anything. And I feel like a lot of my brothers and sisters felt the same way as well. And, you know, I did not expect it at all. I did not want that for any of them. I love, no matter what our communications are, how hard it is, I love them. I want the best for my family. Mm-hmm. But knowing that, you know, I can't do certain things anymore because it might hurt them more than help them.
Right.
And, you know, it was unfortunate in what happened. And still to this day, I can't believe it actually happened. In a lot of ways, but you know, I tried to help
and tried to reach out. Why do they blame
you? Well, I think they probably blame me. I mean, which, you know, a lot of times I actually took it on myself to say, well, it might actually be my fault. But then realizing later on down the road, no, it's not my fault. I am not responsible for, I mean, once you get to that point where you're at 21, 22, 23 years old, you have to assume the responsibility yourself. And want to be different and be better and make a change in your life. And, you know, they just...
And they turn on you and you sit back and say, wait a minute, I've given them so much
money.
I've given them my time. I've been the parent to all these people, and this is what I get for it.
And actually not worrying about myself.
Yeah.
In a lot of ways, see, that's what happens. You know, I use an example. When you're on an airplane, you know, they actually say, well, you put the mask on yourself
first,
before you can help someone else.
Right.
But you didn't grow up that way. You were always taking care of
everyone
else.
It was always about, you know, forget me, mm-hmm. you know, worry about everyone else and everything else, you know, and I think that was tough.
Little brother Aaron, whom we know, he's been on the show several times. How is he doing?
He's doing much better, you know, and he's actually on tour and, you know, business is going good.
Do you worry that he's on tour?
I mean, I worry that... I always worry about them.
Yeah.
I always want the best for them. But again, you know, and I had the same problem with Leslie and Aaron. You know, they want to do their own things. They want to live life themselves and experience it themselves. And sometimes you can't help them.
And they want you to be the big brother, and then they don't want you to be the big brother. I mean, it's that confusing thing.
It's really confusing. All
right, as you sit here today, you're good. You're clean.
You're good.
You say you still could be
a
mess, but
no, there's no doubt. It's a struggle for me when it comes to, you know, alcohol is deeply rooted in my background since I was, you know, young. Drugs I have not touched for 8-9 years since all the issues. Will not ever touch them. But you know, it's a battle for me and
will
it's a struggle.
Will you take a drink of wine if you're with friends?
You know, a drink of wine or two every day. But I have to be careful with that.
Very
and I
careful.
Love health and I want to be.
Yeah.
Sober and so
well, you look
searching.
You look good.
Well, we're really
you
happy
good.
That you're doing so well.
Thank
the book
you.
Is great.
Thank and you so
I
it's
highly
a book,
recommend it.
Again, not just about you and your life, and it is, but it's for other people who read it, and they will see themselves in various ways.
And you really speak to the reader. Yeah. Yeah. I feel like we really get to know.
All right, Nick's going to be signing copies of his book tomorrow at 7 at Barnes & Noble at the Grove. There's a documentary. We'll come back next time for, talk
about the
Backstreet
Boys documentary.
Yeah, we have a documentary to talk about the whole life of B.S.B.
We'll be doing that. All right.